What's up, my fellow Shield Brothers? It is the Shield Brother, here for the History Armada. This day on April 15th, we are talking about an integral part of American history at the cusp of the American Civil War. We are talking about the event of April 15th, 1861, Lincoln's 75,000, otherwise known as the Proclamation on State Militia. So on April 15th of 1861, at the very start of the American Civil War, the President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, had called for a 75,000-man militia to serve for 3 months following the bombardment and surrender of Fort Sumter. This seizing of Fort Sumter being the very integral and very beginning event of the American Civil War, and this proclamation was in response to it. So of course, to begin, we must speak on the issue of secession. Because many of the southern slave states had refused to send troops to Lincoln to aid in any sort of action against their neighboring deep south slave states. And these slave states that they did not want to take action against included South Carolina, Mississippi, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and Texas. With the result that most such states in the upper south, that included such as Virginia, Arkansas, North Carolina, and Tennessee, also declared secession from the United States and instead joined the Confederate States. So here we see this being a kind of a last straw. They refused to send any troops to fight their southern brothers, but instead would leave to join them. Missouri and Kentucky did not fully secede themselves from Union control, but they were admitted by the Confederacy as the 12th and 13th states, respectively, while Maryland and Delaware stayed in the Union throughout the duration of the war. So with these states seceding, Lincoln was in dire need of an increased military. So let us speak on the background. Why was this necessary? Why did he need an increased military? Well, in April of 1861, the regular army of the United States of America consisted of approximately 16,000 officers and soldiers organized into 10 regiments of infantry, 4 of artillery, 2 of cavalry, 2 of dragoons, and 1 of mounted rifles. Only 16,000 men. That's a, especially by today's terms, very small military. These regiments were mostly posted in small forts of company-sized detachments. The majority were posted west of the Mississippi River. Furthermore, following the secession of 7 states from December 1860 to the creation of the Confederate States of America in February of 1861, many officers and soldiers of the regular army had resigned, or in our case as April 1861, were in the process of resigning from the United States Army to join the Army of the Confederacy, such as the 3 naval officers on the left of your screen there. So, with only 16,000 men total for the regular army, and many of them leaving to join the secession, Lincoln needed to increase his military. It was dire straits. So, what were the legal limitations of this proclamation? What could Lincoln actually do by law to get conscripts for the military? Well, until the early 20th century, the United States relied on calling out militia and volunteers rather than expanding the regular army. However, there were restrictions on the number of men and the length of time they could serve that the President of the United States, as opposed to a state governor, could summon. Section 4 of the Militia Act of 1795 says, quote, that the militia employed in the service of the United States shall receive the same pay and allowances as the troops of the United States. So it's saying state militias and the regular army are the same, at least on the pay scale. And that no officer, non-commissioned officer, or private of the militia shall be compelled to serve more than 3 months in any 1 year, just like the other militia, nor more than in due rotation with every other able-bodied man of the same rank in the battalion to which he belongs. So he can't serve more than his compatriots of the same rank. However, on March 2nd, 1799, the number of militiamen able to be called by the President of the United States for a provisional army had been limited to 75,000 men. And prior to 1861 and the Civil War, this limit had never been adjusted to reflect the growth in the nation's population, which increased almost sixfold from 5.3 million in the year of 1800 to more than 31 million in the year of 1860. During that time, there had been no domestic insurrection or conflict in the United States, even to the scale of the short-lived Whiskey Rebellion of the early 1790s. So therefore, there was little impetus, little reason for Congress to reconsider the numerical limits to the militia that had been codified in the Militia Act of 1795. If there had been no violence, no conflict, no uprising, why would there be had been any reason to raise that limit? There had been none. So that's why Lincoln is at this dire strait where he can only call 75,000 men, and his beginning regular army had been decimated. It had only been 16,000, and now men are leaving, and he can only call up 75,000 militia. That's where he's legally limited. But he does just that. He calls up the 75,000 in this declaration I will read for you now. So, the declaration by Lincoln read, quote, by the President of the United States, a proclamation. Whereas the laws of the United States have been for some time past and now are opposed, and the execution thereof obstructed in the states of South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, Florida, Mississippi, Louisiana, and Texas, by combinations too powerful to be suppressed by the ordinary course of judicial proceedings or by the powers vested in the marshals by law. So he's saying, because so many of these states here listed have left and joined together, we need to raise our arms. We cannot stop them in our current state. We need to call up men. Now, to continue the quote, therefore, I, Abraham Lincoln, President of the United States, in virtue of the power in me vested by the Constitution and the laws, I have thought fit to call forth, and hereby do call forth, the militia of the several states of the Union, to the aggregate number of 75,000 men, in order to suppress said combinations and to cause the laws to be duly executed. So he's saying, I'm going to call up the militia from several states of the Union, and we are going to stop these unified southern states, and we are going to enact the laws of the Union. The details for this object will be immediately communicated to the state authorities through the War Department. I appeal to all loyal citizens to favor, facilitate, and aid this effort to maintain the honor, the integrity, and the existence of our national union, and the perpetuity of popular government, and to redress wrongs already long enough endured. I deem it proper to say that the first service assigned to the forces hereby called forth will probably be to repossess the forts, places, and property which have been seized from the Union. And in every event, the utmost care will be observed consistently with the objects aforesaid to avoid any devastation, any destruction of, or interference with property, or any disturbance of peaceful citizens in any part of the country. So he's saying, first things first, what we are gonna do is that we are gonna take these 75,000 men, and we are going to take back what has been stolen from the Union. Fort Sumter, the armaments, the depots of ammunition and arms, we're going to take all that back. We are going to take back the rightful federal possessions. And to continue, he also said, you know, we will do our best and go consistently with the laws to avoid devastation or destruction brought upon any peaceful citizen. So he's saying, as long as you cooperate and you are peaceful, we will not touch you. This is about the men fighting, he says. And I hereby command the persons composing the combinations aforesaid to disperse and retire peaceably to their respective abodes within 20 days from this date. So he's saying, to you southern states that I have listed, to you that have seceded, that are currently taking up arms, if you do not disperse within 20 days, these 75,000 men and the regular army will come down upon you. It was a little too late to be threatening and to be trying to control the situation, as it was already in motion that there would be a Confederate States of America. Lastly, deeming that the present condition of public affairs presents an extraordinary occasion, I do hereby, in virtue of the power in me vested by the Constitution, convene both houses of Congress. Senators and representatives are therefore summoned to assemble at their respective chambers at 12 o'clock noon on Thursday, the 4th day of July, then and there to consider and determine such measures as in their wisdom the public safety and interest may seem to demand. By the President, Abraham Lincoln, Secretary of State, William H. Seward. So we say, not only am I calling up these men, not only are we going to come down and take what is ours, I'm calling both houses of Congress, and I want them to get together and figure out what we're going to do for public safety and get to the bottom of this. What is our course of action? He's saying, we're doing this. I'm doing everything I can in my power in this proclamation. This declaration really showed that he meant business. He was telling them how they were going to do it, when they were going to do it, and what the course was. And I think that was very important for the deciding factors for some of these southern states, as well as perhaps a reassuring feeling that he was giving out in this declaration. So you may be asking, what was the reaction or resistance to this proclamation? Well, as detailed here on the political cartoon on the right, it says secession exploded in death to traitors as they are going to strike out against these secessionists. Well, rather than call for 75,000 military volunteers from any one American state or territory, the second proclamation by Secretary of State William Seward called for a specific number of volunteers from each state. And the Secretary of War's proclamation included slave states in the South that had not yet declared the secession. But it did exclude the two free states on the Pacific coast, California and Oregon, because at the time there was not a transcontinental railroad that had been built, and that would be necessary to transport troops from nations far western regions with any sort of ease. They also excluded the recently admitted Kansas. So, it's kind of important to note that they did require volunteers and they did send out telegrams to the southern states that had not yet succeeded, but they did not call on California, Oregon, or Kansas. Well, several northern states communicated enthusiasm, with states such as Indiana offering twice as many volunteers as was requested. They were gung-ho, they were ready to stand for their union. And Massachusetts volunteers reached Washington, D.C. as early as April 19th. 4 days later, it only took 4 days for the volunteers to reach Washington, D.C. However, on the other hand, there was stark resistance. For instance, Governor Isham Harris of Tennessee stated in a telegram to Lincoln, "Tennessee will furnish not a single man for the purpose of coercion, but 50,000 if necessary for the defense of our rights and those of our southern brothers." So he said, no, I will not give you men to fight the South. I will not give in to your action. In fact, I'll do you one better. I'll give 50,000 men to fight your actions in the South. Furthermore, Governor Beriah Magoffin of Kentucky declared that they would not send volunteers to a northern army intent on subjugating their southern brethren. Similarly, Governor John Letcher of Virginia, whose state had been requested to furnish 3 full regiments totaling 5,340 men and officers, had stated in the past his intent for his state to remain neutral. So in a letter to Lincoln, he declared that since the president had, quote, chosen to inaugurate civil war, he would be sent no troops from the Old Dominion, end quote. Governor Henry Rector of Arkansas stated, "The people of this commonwealth are free men, not slaves, and will defend to the last extremity their honor, lives, and property against northern mendacity and usurpation." So, the governor of Arkansas is saying, we're not slaves. You can't do this to us. We're gonna fight arm and limb for honor, lives, and property against you usurping our rights. So there was Stark resistance, as you can tell, because we did fight an American Civil War over this. Not over this proclamation, but this was already far in swing before this proclamation. But they stood for what they believed in, and the Union brought them back to heel. So what were the subsequent actions of this proclamation? Where did he go from here? Well, in early May, Lincoln gave a second call for an additional 42,000 men. And on May 3rd, President Lincoln issued a further call for United States volunteers to serve 3 years, with regiments to be organized by the state governments, unless sooner discharged. He increased the regular U.S. Army by 22,714 men. And Lincoln called for 42,034 more volunteers to enlist for 3 years. In July 1861, the U.S. Congress sanctioned Lincoln's actions and authorized 500,000 additional volunteers. So, the subsequent action to these reactions and to these resistances was to increase further. He got sanctioned for 500,000 additional volunteers on top of the volunteers and regular expansion. He meant business, and he showed that with the rapid expansion of the U.S. military in the year of 1861. For he was dead set to save the Union, as he would end up doing after bloody years of strife. But these subsequent actions are important, as is it is important of today, April 15th, and the proclamation, because the proclamation is very important for what it showed the government could do, and the precedent it would set for the expansion and calling up of men to serve in times of need, and that would go on to affect later wars. So I hope you enjoyed today. I hope you learned a little bit about the American Civil War on today, April 15th. If you have any comments, questions, or concerns, make sure you drop that down in the comment section below for me. If you like this content, please leave me a like. If you disliked it, go ahead and leave a dislike. If you want to reach me, my email is available, and I will be leaving you the notes and citations in the information box below the video. So on this April 15th, I bid to you farewell until I see you again, and as the Shield Brother for the History Armada, long live the Union, and I'll see y'all next time.